Hello everyone, my name is Sebastian Günther. I'm from the Technical University of Darmstadt in Germany, and today I present you our work where we investigate the interdependency of visual and on-body thermal feedback in virtual reality called Therminator. As we all know, virtual reality is becoming more realistic and has an ever-increasing presence for users. However, those new levels of immersion are nowadays still mostly attributed to an increasing quality of visual and auditory details. Further, recent works extend the immersion even more by adding haptic components such as vibrotactile feedback or similar mechanical forces applied to the user's body. While all of those features indeed leverage virtual reality to the next level, there are still other aspects which are not fully explored yet, such as thermal feedback. So you may ask, why do we need thermal feedback? Well, the most obvious reasons are, of course, to simulate warmth or coldness. However, we also need to consider such temperature changes on different scales, such as environmental effects or thermal object properties like a hot mug. And last but not least, temperature can evoke emotions and well on all beings through social experiences. Okay. So, before we can apply thermal feedback to users, we need to have to look at some design considerations. First of all, we have to take care of the temperature range. Hereby, we need to consider the neutral skin temperature, which lies usually between 30 and 36 degrees Celsius. However, the range has to be limited since we do not want to cause any pain and take care of thermal pain thresholds, which lie at around 15 degrees Celsius as a lower boundary and around 45 to 52 degrees as an upper boundary. Besides the temperature, we also need to consider different anatomical properties of the human body, such as different shapes of different body parts. For example, we have a straight leg, a convex abdomen, or a bent spine. Further, as humans differ in size, body parts are also not equal. For example, the upper leg is almost twice the size as the lower arm and can even vary between individual persons. And last but not least, we do not want to restrict any movements and have to consider varying degrees of freedom of different body parts, which can have multiple joints and are able to bend or stretch. So, in summary, the requirements for thermal feedback are with a good thermal conductivity, adapting to shapes and size, and needs to be flexible at body joints. As thermal feedback is, of course, not completely new, related approaches often rely on contact-based solutions, such as thermoelectric Peltier elements. Those have very good thermal properties and also have the advantage of being small, lightweight, and can provide very localized feedback. However, due to their nature, they tend to have a high power consumption and can restrict movements through their rigidity, especially when simulating larger areas. In contrast, there also exist non-contact-based solutions which use external heating units or fans. Those also have good thermal properties, but also have the advantage to not hinder any movements. However, since they are not directly attached to the body, it is not trivial to activate specific body parts while the user is on the move. So, to overcome those disadvantages, we thought, why not using liquids as a medium to transfer temperature? And for this, liquids have the good advantage to have good thermal properties and can be used very flexible. In particular, we had a look at water, which has a thermal conductivity of roughly 0.6 watt per meter times Kelvin. Of course, liquids need to be inside some container to be actually useful, so we decided to take tubes which we can adjust, bend, and where a liquid with different temperature can flow through. For this, our tubes had to have similar thermal conductivity as water and allows for enough flexibility, which we found in the tubes made of polyethylene of raised temperature resistance, or short PERT tubes. Using such tubes allows us to have different arrangements and numbers of interconnected subtubes in grill-like patterns to activate small or large regions of the body. Further, we can reshape the tubes to adapt to different body parts and also are able to vary the length of each tube. As a proof of concept, we decided to design two actuators. The first can actuate the upper and lower arm. Here we use eight subtubes, which are connected through flexible PVC connectors to avoid movement restriction at the elbow joint. Second, we designed an abdomen actuator which aims to provide thermal feedback to a more flat part of the body and with a different anatomical shape than the arm. Finally, both are connected to our system's water cycle. So how does it look like? As you can see here, we have the PERT tubes in red, which are connected by very flexible transparent PVC tubes. In the current prototype, we'll use a flow rate of about 40 milliliters per second, which resulted in a temperature change of around 2 degrees per second, as visible in the thermal camera view on the left. For changing the temperature of each actuator, we mix a hot and cold water source using a thermal mixing valve. An electronic magnetic solenoid valve is used to control the actuation. We then measure the flow rate and inner temperature of the liquid and are able to adjust the flow rate through a pressure regulator. Then the liquid reaches two additional magnetic valves which controls the flow to the abdomen and arm actuators. And after having our system ready, we implemented three example applications which I will show you now. In the first, the user is a pirate on an island and needs to find precious gems. Those can be found in the water, which will cool down the user's arm when reaching for them. In the second application, a user plays a snowball game, and every time he gets hit by a snowball, the abdomen cools down quickly and slowly returns to the neutral temperature after some time. In a final application, we simulate an emergency task where the user has to put off fires in a building. The more flames are extinguished, the cooler the environment gets. And okay, after this we thought, why should we stop here? Because there's something we still can do, as virtual reality can simulate unfamiliar situations such as having hot burning ice cubes. So we ask ourselves, what happens if thermal and visual stimuli do not match the temperature and do not match the temperature expectations of the user? For example, on the left, snow turns warm, and on the right, the fire turns cold. Therefore, we defined three research questions which we wanted to investigate. First, how does the interdependency of thermal and visual stimuli affect the perceived temperature? Second, how do the thermal and visual stimuli affect the involvement of the users? And third, we ask how do the thermal and visual stimuli affect the comfort of the users? And to answer those questions, we first had to define how the thermal stimuli will look like. Hereby, we used the neutral skin temperature at 32.5 degrees Celsius as a starting point. We then increased the temperature in 5 degrees steps until we reached 42.5 degrees Celsius, so we stay below the upper pain threshold. We also did the same in the opposite direction and decreased the temperature in 5 degrees steps until reaching 22.5 degrees Celsius, which is just above the lower pain threshold, resulting in 5 total thermal stimuli. For the visual stimuli, however, we had to identify meaningful visualizations. As Fenko et al. Stated, objects convey different expectations of their temperature based on two factors. First, a literal or physical meaning, which conveys the actual temperature. And second, a figurative meaning that describes temperature by learned experiences. So, to do so, we interviewed 7 HCI experts and asked them for visualizations, objects and other things connected to temperature which they should rank from very cold to hot. Afterwards, we collected all the answers, clustered all items and counted the column elements. This resulted in the following 5 visual stimuli, which we applied as visualizations for the arm as well for the abdomen. We have a very cold snow visualization, a cold rain cloud, no visualization as our neutral visual stimulus, a warm heating lamp, and a hot fire close to the user's body. For the procedure, I don't want to go into much detail. Basically, what we did, we used a within subject design with 25 participants. All of them were provided with a long sleeve, were sitting on a chair and wearing our actuators beforehand. Each participant either then started with the arm or abdomen, and during each condition, we combined each thermal stimulus with each visual stimulus and exposed each combination to the user for about half a minute. Afterwards, we reset both to their neutral stimuli and asked to answer a questionnaire in VR, which I will show you in a second. In total, this was repeated for all 50 combinations. At the end, we asked for additional qualitative feedback through a final questionnaire and informal interviews. As mentioned before, after each combination of the visuals of the stimuli, we ask to fill out a questionnaire with the following four questions. How do you rate the thermal sensation? How do you rate the thermal comfort? How much did the visual aspects involve you? And how much did the thermal aspects involve you? In the following, I will present you our main findings. However, if you're interested in more details, especially in lots of numbers and statistics, I would like to invite you to have a look at our paper. So, okay, let's dig in to our results. As the first main result, we identified that every thermal stimulus always overrides the perception of visual stimuli. So, for example, if we have a fire visualization combined with a cold stimulus, it still feels cold. As you can see here, where a lower number basically means a lower perceived thermal sensation and a higher number means a higher perceived temperature sensation. This was true for all other visualizations, and the participants were always rating the applied thermal stimulus as main factor for their temperature perception. However, if we take a closer look to the numbers, we can see that the visual stimuli still have marginal effects on the temperature perception. For example, for a neutral thermal stimulus, we see a significant higher rating while being exposed to a fire visualization compared to a snow visualization, which is also indicated by differences in the minimum and maximum ratings of the participants. One interesting side effect we could observe was an unexpected small shift for the rain visualization, which resulted by some participants describing it as warm shower instead of a cold rain cloud. Regarding the involvement, we could identify that concurrent stimuli increased the involvement. As you can see here, a neutral visual stimulus, so no visualization at all, resulted in no involvement as expected. However, similar as before, a neutral thermal stimulus is affected by the shown visualizations, as you can see here. Taking a closer look at matching stimuli, which we can find at the lower left and upper right parts of each graph, we can clearly see significant higher involvement ratings as compared to non-matching stimuli, which were often described as uncanny or even uncomfortable. Last but not least, with regards to the participants' comfort, we found that the level of comfort highly depends on the applied thermal stimulus. As you can see here, our analysis revealed a significant higher comfort for neutral and slightly warmer temperatures compared to colder stimuli. As a result, the overall consensus was that temperatures generally could even be warmer, but should not get colder, as more chill temperatures were perceived as uncomfortable and more intense. And before concluding my talk, we, of course, identified some limitations. First of all, we only investigated the abdomen and arm and need to identify how other body parts will perceive the thermal stimuli provided by our system. Also, we only combined one visual and one thermal stimulus per condition. However, what would happen if we have multiple stimuli combined at once or even actuate different body parts with different stimuli at the same time? And lastly, while not described as restricting the users more than the HMD cable, our system currently relies on an external source which needs to pump the liquids to the actuators. Hence, we need to find reliable ways to increase the wearability, for example by having smaller amounts of liquids and thermal devices in a wearable backpack. And hereby I want to conclude my talk where I presented you Therminator. I presented you a set of concepts and design considerations, a prototype along with three example applications, and a systematic evaluation investigating the interdependency of thermal and visual stimuli, where we found that thermal stimuli always override visual stimuli, concurrent stimuli increase the involvement, and the comfort depends on the thermal stimulus. I would like to thank you for your attention, and if you have any further questions or comments, feel free to contact me directly. And also, if you're interested, check out the other great Chi20 talks by my Team Darshat colleagues from the Tele Corporation Lab. So, thanks and stay healthy.